Hello, very good morning. Welcome along to a brand new week here on Ireland AM and Virgin Media One.
Yes, indeed. It is Monday, the 8th of April. And thank you so much for joining us the day when the children are going back to school. Freedom again.
A lot of happy parents out there. It has been a long 2 weeks. My goodness. Celebrations at home this morning. But enjoy school, kids.
Anyway, yes,
coming up at 7.45, we're going to be taking a look at the headlines you are waking up to, including, of course, Leo Bradgert's last day as Taoiseach as he passes the reins over to Simon Harris.
You loved all the celebrating at the Oirdheis, did you?
What? Don't even get me started.
Well, we will at 7.45. We'll also be speaking to Tess Ingram. Tess is from UNICEF and she's currently in Rafah. She'll be talking to us about the situation in Gaza. Obviously, a huge amount has happened over the weekend. That's coming up at 7.35 this morning.
Plus, back at home, our resident GP, Dr. Kiva Hartley, she's going to be here and she's going to answer your questions. We know how difficult it is in the health service at the minute. So if you do have any questions that you want to put to our GP, to Kiva, WhatsApp us on 0896 111 111, and we'll get her to answer as many as she can.
He's sitting pretty over the breakfast bar. Hello, Alan. What else do we have coming
sitting
up today?
Pretty happy Monday. Yes, lots of other stuff to come on today's show as well, including tweed jackets and blouses. That's right, we're doing the rich grandma look on today's catwalk. And we have a Channing Tatum lookalike, and he's going to put myself and Tommy through our magic mic moves. Yeah, Tommy's already practicing. What else could you ask for of a Monday? There you go. It's all sit-ups.
Flat out sit-ups all morning.
Yeah. What was that sound you did earlier on? We've got to save it for the end of the show.
9.45. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Alan. Looking forward to that.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
This morning will be rather cold, with outbreaks of mostly light rain continuing to spread north and west across the country. Highest temperatures of 6 to 8 degrees. Moving on to this afternoon, and areas of moderate to heavy rain are likely across Leinster and southern Munster, leading to a threat of flooding there. Highest temperatures of 7 to 10 degrees. And tonight, showery rain will continue to affect the east coast. Elsewhere will be largely dry, with cloud cover breaking up and clearer spells developing more widely. Minimum temperatures of 6 to 8 degrees.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Now it's time to take a look at this morning's papers. We're going to start with the Irish Times, the headline there. Harris considers €70 million boost for business. Plans to increase sick leave days could be paused and businesses could be in line for a €70 million tax boost as part of a package of supports promised by Taoiseach designate Simon Harris.
Be ready for an election, Harris tells internal Fine Gael committees. Simon Harris has asked party members for manifesto ideas to support farming and small businesses, in a sign he is already gearing up for a general election, but insists it's not his intention to hold an election this year. That's the top story on the Daily Mail.
The Examiner's front page, social media, a health risk for young. Social media use is creating broken people and it should be considered a public health risk, according to a stark warning from experts in psychiatry and the online sphere.
Fine Gael fears that moving McEntee will be seen as a cave-in to the far right. There are fears within the highest ranks of Fine Gael that moving Helen McEntee out of the Department of Justice could feed into the far-right anti-immigrant agenda. That's front page of the Irish Independent.
The Mirror goes with Puff the Magic Jacket. A young girl had a miraculous escape after she was washed into the sea at the height of Storm Kathleen. The seven-year-old who was walking along the Dunleary Pier was saved when a capsule of air became trapped in her jacket, which kept her afloat.
The Herald also covers this incredible story. Their headline is Girl 7 in Sea Saved by Her Puffer Jacket.
And The Sun says, plucked from the jaws of death.
And finally, The Star leads with Life Jacket. Hero volunteer dived in to save her. Andrew Sykes was on board the RNLI lifeboat involved in the rescue, entered the water to grab hold of the seven-year-old girl.
Thank God she's doing all right.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable scenes there. Now, coming up on Ireland AM, it's all of the sporting action from over the weekend, including Munster's crash out of the Champions
League. And have Liverpool let go of the Premier League? We're going to be discussing it all after the break. morning. You're very welcome back. Now, from the Premier League action to European rugby, it certainly was a busy old weekend in the world of sport.
Joining us to talk is the 42.ie's Gavin Cooney and former Dublin footballer Paddy Andrews. Thank you both so much for being here today. We really appreciate it. But I suppose that news that we heard yesterday, Gavin, about Joe.
Very sad. Yeah, I think he was only 77. Joe has had dementia for years, so probably had a sad end of life. But what a life he did indeed leave. Obviously played for, he did play for Ireland. He's probably best known as a football manager, really, with Wimbledon and then later on with Luton Forest and most recently with Newcastle United in the Premier League. So, yeah, very sad news.
And 26 caps for Ireland, of course, as well. So our condolences go out to his family and friends. This morning, we'll move on to another match, a big match at the top of the table of the Premier League yesterday. Liverpool, who are trying to extend their lead at the top of the table, up against old foes Manchester United. I suppose I have to come to you on this one, Paddy. As a Man United supporter, you could have won. You could have won it.
You weren't expecting much going into it. It was very similar to the cup game. It was a brilliant, brilliant match. Again, Liverpool completely dominated. For United, scored two world class goals out of nowhere. Kobe Mainoo, who's been kind of the most.
He was so afterwards. I've never seen him like that.
Such a better team. Yeah. And it's so tight between Arsenal, Liverpool, and Man City.
Yeah.
You can't really afford slip ups. Without a doubt, yesterday was a slip-up for Liverpool. But for Man United, almost a famous victory. But I think they did well to get a draw out of it.
Because it's so tight at the top of the table, and this would be the perfect send-off for Klopp with a Premier League title. They had the lead there. Like, they were the favourites, probably. And this slip-up has really cost them and could cost them going into the final couple of games.
I think it really could. Like, obviously, there's a lot of road to run now, with still each of the three teams at the top of the table still have seven games to go. But the pace is such that teams can't really afford to drop points. And Liverpool, what's most frustrating for them, like, a draw at Old Trafford historically is not a bad result for them. They should have won this game. They had chances to win it 2-3 times over, the same as the cup game. So they've been too wasteful in the big games, and maybe that's ultimately what's going to cost them, because, look, there is, as we say, there's a long way to go, but Arsenal, and particularly City, they don't look like dropping points.
No.
They really don't.
Obvious.
And City have a good run in as well.
They have a handy run in. It'd be Spurs quite worried. Away, otherwise, they'll win the ball.
We moved to Gaelic football then as well. There was a Division 1 final in the women's football yesterday. Armagh came out on top against Kerry.
Yeah, first ever league title, I believe, for Armagh. Led, obviously, by the brilliant Damie Mackin. But 3 points to spare on Kerry. So it'll be interesting to see, can they take that into the championship as well? But regardless of what it means going forward, it's obviously a fantastic achievement in and of itself.
Absolutely huge for them. We'll move on to Monaghan took on Cavan yesterday.
Tommy.
Titans of the football. How are you doing this morning, Cavan?
Dodgy goals.
Cavan being victorious.
The championship obviously kicked off this weekend. It actually wasn't a bad weekend. A couple of surprises. Cavan beat Monaghan, probably not a massive surprise, but it was. Monaghan would have been favourites going in. It was in Clonus, obviously, as well. It was a pretty good game.
Yeah.
Which was the fact
that it was tight.
It was. The Ulster Championship is, along
not
with
the best spectacle.
It's the tightest championship because every team can beat each other. At this stage, I suppose the big story pre-match was Rory Beggan, who's been away trying to get the NFL for the last couple of months. He started for Monaghan, had a massive impact. They lead going into injury time, and Cavan turned it around with two goals. So a famous victory for them. Other big shocks, Ushie McConville's Wicklow, who were relegated to Division 4, they beat Westmeath in the Leinster Championship, which was a big surprise. Waterford beat Tipperary in the Munster Championship as well. So a couple of shocks and surprises to kick off the football championship. But
which is promising. It's what we want, right, from the championship.
The big thing last year, if you remember, the Munster Hurling Championship is kind of keeps the show on the road through April and May. That kicks off in the next couple of weeks as well. And the football championship doesn't really get going, or hasn't previously, until the end of May, start of June. But yesterday, it's an early start for the championship. Obviously, it's the second weekend of April. But it was a pretty good start. A couple of shocks always help.
Crowds biggest of low. Crowds. Yeah. I was going to say that. Like, in Clonus, Cavan against Monaghan, two local derbies, and even in a couple of the matches,
I suppose because of Storm Kathleen, maybe parents were just being a little bit reticent.
I think it was only 8,500.
But there's so many games. That's, like, it's
Cavan play Tyrone in 2 weeks' time.
Yeah.
The National Leagues have just finished. It's week on week on week. It can be quite expensive if you're going to every single game. The weather, perhaps, as well. But just the nature, like, both Cavan and Monaghan will play another 7 or 8 championship matches this year.
It's supporter burnout. Yeah. We've obviously heard a lot about player burnout.
Read an article, somebody saying that people are getting a bit fed up with the GAA a little bit, and maybe voting with their feet and not turning up to those matches. I mean, let us know what you think of that as well.
I suppose last week with them threatening to sue Supermax over the April Fool's joke.
Everyone
was giving out. What did you make about that?
A bit much, wasn't it?
It was kind of like, thou shalt not take the name GAA in vain sort of a thing.
They don't help themselves at times, though.
Yeah.
That was surprising. And I think the reaction online as well was a bit...
It was a bit like, calm down, lads.
Relax, lads.
It's April Fool's, for goodness sake.
Yeah. We'd love to know what you think about that. You know, burnout from going to all these matches. 0896111111.
Let's move on to the rugby then as well. A couple of big matches. Ulster beat Montpellier. Connacht beat Pau. But Munster at Northampton was a cracker of a match.
Great game, yeah. And Munster, I don't know, I thought Munster did pretty well to stick with Northampton up until the final quarter, because they're so denuded by injury.
Big time.
And then they had an illness running through the camp. Yeah. So Orgy Snyman kind of typically missed this game.
I swear to God, when is he going to actually make it after the pitch?
For Leinster. He'll play every minute for Leinster.
Has he been spotted in Munster?
I think Craig Casey got sick during this game.
Todd
Byrne was in a coughing fit after the game. So disappointing, and it meant that Munster just didn't have the depth off the bench to match Northampton in the final quarter. Northampton are a serious team, I think.
They're top of the English Premiership at the minute.
The damage for Munster was done in the pool stage, wasn't it? That they kind of messed up a couple of home games. Northampton bet Munster in Palmer Park before Christmas, and that resulted in Munster getting a really tough away draw to the leading team in the Premiership. And they just kind of ran out of puff, didn't they? Yeah. Just that power, the depth.
You could kind of see it with Jack Crowley and Simon Zeebo in that last try.
Yeah.
That they looked so tired in the second half. Bless them.
It's down to Ronan O'Gara to carry on the Munster hopes and beat Leinster next weekend.
Well, that's it. So obviously, Leinster-Leicester was a cracker of a game. I think that was on Saturday night as well.
Yeah.
And Leicester Tigers, who obviously are European Cup winners, put up a hell of a fight. Leinster are just looking so, so impressive. So it does tee up La Rochelle this weekend, like in the quarterfinal, because that's been the final the last couple of years. La Rochelle have had the upper hand over Leinster. It's going to be a hell of a game.
Oh, this is the big rivalry of kind of the last few years. You know, as you say, it's usually been the final. La Rochelle have kind of slipped up a little bit in the pool stages, so that's why they're meeting early. Leinster did beat them, I think, in the pool stages, but... What does that matter? You know, I mean, La Rochelle have got it done in the days that matter. So
I got it. So La Rochelle had to go and beat, I think it was the Stormers over in...
It was 16-0 down.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Vintage Ronan O'Gara-esque turnaround. He has them in Cork for the week.
Well, this is it, so I love that.
I know, yeah.
There's an ambush coming. But for Leinster, like, there'll be a massive crowd Saturday night in the event. Like, La Rochelle have beaten the last three times in this tournament. The semi-final and then the last two finals.
Yeah.
They can't lose again. They can't.
We'll see. But it will be a brilliant Saturday.
It will
night
be a brilliant
Viva.
Match. No, it will.
Raj will have something.
I love that he's taking them to Cork for the week.
Long Island, I would imagine.
Down to the English market. Here we go. Get some coffee. Exactly.
We'll be in Crane Lane on Tuesday night. It'll be all good. And just really quickly for Leona Maguire, she was playing last night in the HSBC Women's Championship. Unfortunately, Nelly Cordes, she beat her to extend this amazing record that she's had. But Leona did a great job.
Yeah, Leona's probably one of the best match play players in the world. We've seen her in the Solheim Cup. Got to the final last night, but Nelly Corda is on a hell of a run. That's four straight tournament victories, which is fairly astonishing.
What a weekend for Cavan. It could have been.
She looks so annoyed.
Should have, would have, could
have. She looks so annoyed. Fair play, Leona, though.
Listen, Paddy Andrews and Gam Cooney from 42, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Fair play to you, lads.
We'll be back with you on Ireland AM in just a minute.
You're very welcome back. Now, of course, we are 6 months into the conflict over in Gaza and 1 week on from the Israeli airstrike, which killed 7 humanitarian workers who were delivering essential aid.
That brings to 196 the amount of humanitarian aid workers that have been killed in Gaza. And we're talking about 33,000 Palestinians having been killed. Joining us from Rafah to discuss is communications specialist with UNICEF, Tess Ingram. Tess, thank you so much for joining us this morning. You were in Rafah. What's the situation there like at the moment? You said earlier on, just a few minutes ago to us, it was a hard night with a lot of was there bombs going off last night?
Yeah, you know, of course there was this news of troops withdrawing, but then it was a very loud night here in the air last night. Planes circling, some explosions nearby. So it's certainly continuing here on the ground. And, you know, as aid workers, we try and remind ourselves that, you know, we're here because it's unsafe for children. And I can only imagine what it would have been like being a child in a tent last night with that really loud noise overhead.
My goodness, I think we can hear that. Is that the sound of planes overhead at the moment?
Yeah, that's right. That's another one.
My goodness, I mean, terrifying for yourselves, for everybody over there, but even for myself, having children, I can't even imagine what it must be like for parents trying to look after them. Of course, you are an aid worker over there at the minute. Moran mentioned over 100 aid workers have been killed since this conflict began, 7 last week. What is the reaction on the ground to you in UNICEF and other amazing aid organisations whenever you see other people who are only trying to do their job and to try to do their best to help people on the ground there, whenever you see people losing their lives?
Yeah, of course it's heartbreaking. We, you know, these are our colleagues that, you know, whether we know them or not, we're all part of the same team here trying to help people in Gaza. But it's also incredibly frustrating because it's against the rules of war. Even wars have laws, and you know, we're meant to be protected as international humanitarian workers. And when we go out on a mission and we're told it's going to be safe, we need to know that that's true. I'm about to go out on one now, and it's always in the back of your mind that, you know, am I going to be okay today? But like I said earlier, this is not really about us. This is about the kids that we're here to serve. And however dangerous it is for us, it's even more dangerous for them.
But of course, like we know, we're talking about 33,000 people that have died, and the Palestinians that have died. And we do know that not all the hostages have been returned to Israel from that raid on October the 7th. But when you go out and you tell the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force, we are going out on this mission now, you have to believe that they're not going to target you. And when that's what happened last week, and they were still targeted. Has the trust been lost there?
Well, look, I think, you know, it's as we said, it's been 6 months. It's been almost 200 humanitarian aid workers. It's really clear that this system is broken. It works in other parts of the world. This is a notification system that we use in conflicts from Haiti to Sudan to Afghanistan. So there's no reason why it can't work here in Gaza. We just need assurances that it's going to be respected. And it's clear that at the moment, when we get a safety assurance, it doesn't mean a lot.
Can you explain to us what the situation is like there at the moment? We know that they're talking about it's the highest level of starvation ever recorded. There's huge risk of famine. What is it like? What are you seeing whenever you're going out to deliver aid?
Yeah, it's really heartbreaking. And it's, you know, I've read the data, I've spoken about it for months, but seeing it firsthand, seeing a child lying in a hospital bed, suffering from malnutrition, which is just so painful for their tiny bodies, it's honestly heartbreaking. I was in the middle area earlier this week on Wednesday, and I met a little boy called Omar who had just come down from the north 48 hours ago, and his grandmother was telling me that they were collecting and cooking grass as their main food source because there was nothing else up there. And you could see in him that he was so, so sick. Fortunately, the doctors at the hospital think that he'll make a recovery now that he's able to receive treatment, which is really good news. But they also said that 90% of the children being admitted to that hospital have malnutrition, which just has to be unacceptable to the world when we know that there's food and nutrition treatments that can save these children's lives just a few kilometres away from where they're suffering in a hospital.
So we believe that that Palestinians are now surviving on, it's thought to be 200 and I think about 90 calories a day. So that's kind of a tin of beans. And is the aid, because this is the issue, we're like the aid needs to get in order to stop the starvation that seems to be happening, whether that's being used as a mode of warfare or not. That's not what we're talking about right now. So is the aid getting in now?
Not yet at scale, and this is what we've really been pushing for, is to make sure it gets in quickly, but also at scale and consistently. Because if the aid isn't consistent, you know, there might be one meal that a family gets and they don't know whether they'll get another one for 2 weeks. And that increases the desperation in the community, and obviously it affects their health and nutrition. Yeah. So, for example, across the month of March, we averaged 156 trucks a day. Before the war, it was 500. So we really need to get the numbers up and sustain them in order to prevent this looming famine.
How are your colleagues at the moment? How are the people on the ground in terms? I mean, we're 6 months into this conflict now. It doesn't look like there's any ceasefire on the horizon. In terms of food-wise, in terms of just, you must be exhausted. People trying to do their best. And just getting no help, it seems like, from the Israeli government or the IDF.
Yeah, look, it's obviously frustrating to be here as a humanitarian aid worker and not being able to do what we know that we can do, and that, you know, we've proved we can save lives in other places around the world, and it's just not happening here to the degree that we would want. However, the people I speak to are exhausted. Yeah. They just want this war to end. They want food. They need water. They need clean clothes, somewhere to live. The list is long. And you know, I was at a hospital yesterday where I met children who've been injured in the war, and they're sitting there in huge casts, and some of them were orphans, and just not knowing what's going to happen to them now, particularly with word of a ground offensive in Rafah. These children know that, and they're scared.
OK, so let's talk a little bit about that. I know that you are an aid worker, but there's a lot going on an international scale. So troops have been pulled out. They say the troops are being pulled out from southern Gaza to kind of get them to have a reset. But Hamas and Israel delegates, they're travelling to Egypt for another round of ceasefire talks today or this week. Do you have any hopes here, Tess?
We have to. We have to be hopeful. We have to hope that everyone seeing the images, hearing the news, and has decided that this has gone on long enough. We have to see an end to the fighting. We have to see the release of hostages, and we have to get more aid in. And the only way to do that is with a ceasefire. So, yeah, I'm really hopeful that those talks will come to fruition. But also, of course, the news of a ground offensive in Rafah is really daunting, and it would be an absolute catastrophe. I can't say that enough. For the people here in Gaza, it really is a city of children. When you walk around, there's 600,000 kids in a city of 1.2 million. So every second person is a child.
Wow. Listen, Tess, we can just say to you, listen, try to stay safe. I know that you're heading out on a mission today. You're doing incredible stuff, of course, over in UNICEF. We can hear the Australian accent, but I know your mum is Irish as well. So listen, keep doing what you're doing, and hopefully there will be an end in sight. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Tess Ingram from UNICEF.
Harrowing to hear 600,000 children making up half the population, and they're talking about a ground offensive. We'll be hearing more about that throughout the day, of course, on Virgin Media Television. And coming up, we'll get today's top stories on Ireland AM. Now, there was a pledge by Simon Harris to hit the ground running and put an end to the housing crisis once and for all.
There's a statement.
I mean, it's going to be so simple. It occupies much of the papers this morning as Leo Varadkar hands in his resignation to Michael D. Higgins later on today.
Yes, joining us with that story and everything else this morning is editor of the journal.ie, Sinead O'Carroll. Good morning, Sinead. Thanks for joining us.
Yep.
So Leo's last day.
Yeah, it's going to be a big week, kind of a lot of set pieces. We kind of know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. We've heard from Simon Harris a lot over the last 2 weeks. So it's kind of been this, he was so ready for the race that we didn't even know was happening that, you know, this is a combination of Fine Gael, Leo.
literally like he had it all ready to go, didn't he?
Like, it was boom, boom, boom. Yeah. And so, you know, I'd say he was planning that Ardèche.
He would have had the baby bag packed as soon as he found out his wife was pregnant. Yeah, like, he is prepared.
He was on it. But the thing is, are you prepared to fix the housing crisis? Is anybody prepared to fix the housing crisis? And when you look at the priorities that he has, he's a very short amount of time, like, you know, 11 months probably, if the government make it to term. What's the thing that he thinks he can get done? So that's what I was watching on the Ardèche speech. OK, what does he think? Because he can only really promise one, max two things. So what he thinks he can get done is 250,000 homes.
Yes, but he did say, because a lot of people were like, how are you going to do 50,000 houses a year when you've said that it's going to be 35? And he said, I haven't said 50,000 houses a year. I've said in 5 years, there will be an extra 250,000 homes.
But we won't even know that if that's true, because the next election will be next May or March, probably.
And we also don't know if he'll be able to take the credit for whatever has been put into place. But
yeah,
it probably does signal that they know there's enough happening in the works, that there is enough going on in home purchasing and new bills, that he won't be completely left with Eggman's face.
Well, it's not good news today, because he says going to fix the housing crisis, and then we've got a new survey. It's running in the news by myhome.ie that shows the median asking price for a home is up 6.5% nationally.
Yeah, and I guess it depends on which side of this you're on. We're in about whether you see it as, because there is a lot of activity. So, you know, this housing market review from Bank of Ireland, myhome.ie, says there's a lot of activity, more so than there was last year, but that has also meant that there is inflation in house prices. Mm-hmm. So where the figure was 1% last year, it's now 4.6% this year above asking prices. So there are people buying homes, there are people getting into properties, and a lot of them are first-time buyers, but they're paying over the nose.
Over the money. Is this increase in it, is it because people now are seeing that, oh, the European Central Bank, we've been told, will start to decrease interest rates, so that people are saying, OK, it's not going to be as expensive.
Yeah, and they're also looking at, OK, inflation in general is going down as well. So, like, we'll
figure out... They're thinking good time to buy, maybe.
Good time to buy. Also, well, we just have to buy.
It's not a good time to buy. It's like, buy now or it's going to go even higher.
And there's a lot of people who just absolutely have to. The rental market just isn't there for people and their needs. So if you're trying to move on in different stages of your life, if you're, you know, moving out of college and you need to get out of the college rental system, you're in your 20s, moving into your 30s, you might be thinking about starting a family, you might, you know, just have more, accumulated more things, you might be moving to a different area, you might want to move back home. So the rental market isn't working for people, so therefore they feel like they absolutely have to buy, and the more you have, you then will go to the pin of your collar.
To get in contact, 0896 111 111. And very quickly, just something interesting from this is that he might put on pause, if you're a small business owner, it was said that what was coming in this year was that you would have to give 10 days worth of sick leave pay. It was 5 and it was meant to increase. And small business owners have been like, we cannot afford this.
Yeah, it was meant to increase to 10 by 2026.
So there
was meant to be an incremental increase then this year. And they're saying, OK, we'll pause this and we might have... So Michael McGrath, Finance Minister, said there's absolutely not going to be a mini budget before the actual budget, September, October. But there has been this kind of business package mooted of between 50 and 70 million, according to Jennifer Brain, the Irish Times today, that, you know...
Is it on tax breaks?
It'll be on PRSI changes. So but if you are paying... So you have staff who are on now a higher minimum wage and also they get more sick leave. What the adjustment might be is on PRSI, so you pay less of them. It'll take them longer to get to the higher rate of PRSI. So that might be one of the adjustments that is made.
Another one that Simon Harris was saying, that he's going to help the farmers, the rain. For farmers.
Oh, I know. Listen, for everything with the crops, they haven't been able to do anything.
So he said the emergency, some money is needed there, definitely.
Yeah, and I think there is. And one of the things, so one of the fun things about a new Taoiseach is that you get the cabinet reshuffle. It's less fun when there's less places up for grabs, but it's something that we can pretend we're like
and
the
we'll
sports guys on the couch.
Yeah, we'll know that tomorrow
but
night.
That'll be another thing with the farmers, because he does need to have some rural representation rather than another Dublin.
Yeah. We'd love to hear from you, small and medium enterprises, what you make about the sick leave, what you make about the PRSI and farmers as well. 0896 111 111. There is a meeting happening today, which I think is very interesting. This is about people with disabilities and the barriers that they encounter in society, which are unknown to so many of us able-bodied people.
Yeah, and I think this, I was thinking about this morning, it's one of the things that social media is actually, I think, sometimes a positive. I think over the last maybe 5 years, we have heard from a lot of people who are living their lives in a way that is just not as accessible as it should be. Mm. There are small things that should be done when we are planning our cities, when we're building our homes, when we're putting together our schools, that should be done differently because there are so many people who have hidden and visible disabilities. So this Oireachtas Committee are meeting more than 20 witnesses to talk about things like transport, healthcare, social protection, the built environment, things like, you know, when you're on the path and there's loads of signs or chairs or poles put up and no
or
one
cars
is
parking up on the footpath, you know, in your own estate,
like that, like here, or you know, you go to the train station and the lift isn't working. You know, how do people then who require that lift to get on the train manage to go about their day as planned if those things happen?
Because I think we would think we've come very far in it, or but obviously we haven't come far enough easily. Like, I mean, there's so much, when you just think of things like that, roadworks on the street. And somebody with who may be blind or going down the street, who's always walks down that street, and suddenly that day, but there's
even,
all these.
But even people not picking up their dog poo when you're in a wheelchair. Oh, yeah. You know what I mean? Like, that's someone's hands, man. Yeah. Pick up after your dog.
It's my biggest issue when county council candidates are coming to my door at the moment.
Really?
Yep, like the dog issue.
It does have these far-reaching effects. Yeah. If you're talking about this, if you're in a wheelchair,
wheelchairs.
This committee is happening today in relation to people, how they find their lives if they have a disability. We'd love to hear from you about that. What it's like for you when you're just trying to go about your day that other people just don't realise. 0896 111 111. Thank you so much for that one.
A story that was all over the papers this morning about this girl who was saved in Dunleary from Storm Kathleen over the weekend. An amazing story that her puffer jacket and some air in the puffer jacket kept her afloat.
It's incredible. So there is footage of the actual rescue, the heroes from the RNLI who got themselves together so quickly to get out to her. She was so calm. She had managed, they're not sure if it was on purpose or because of the jacket, she managed to get into the exact correct position that you're meant to get into, arms out, like in the Float to Live campaign. And she's in the puffer jacket, which they think helped her kind of either get into that position or keep her there and keep her calm.
Yeah.
And so they said when they found her, she was calm, even though they had to kind of go to her first, didn't manage to get to her initially. And then the RNLI, one of the RNLI crew, jumped into the sea and helped her then and got pulled onto the boat. I can't imagine how just grateful the family are.
I could imagine
what their day
the parents,
could have been today within a few minutes difference.
And it did seem like it's overwhelming. The crowd, I just know that you're kind of getting choked up about it because the crowd on Dunleary Pier, they were all there. They were trying to put boys together to get them into sea, but the wind was just so rough and everyone just ringing on their phones. And how quick the RNLI
got
out.
All of these people who have obviously trained to the nth degree and just give their time for these things. And I know these moments are what they do it for, so that they can actually make such a difference, like me and her.
It's unbelievable. They are amazing. Yeah. And a friend of mine, Paddy, he's one of the pilots in the helicopter.
Yeah.
And the stuff they see every day and the things they have to do, and they're just amazing.
Tell you one thing, every parent is going to be buying that puffer jacket when they find out what make it is.
And I think we all know a bit more about, you know, putting the arms out, 100%. Getting yourself into a floating position to give yourself that time to get used to the shock. Yeah. And then you've bought yourself some time, so that's what that little girl did. It's
amazing.
Absolutely amazing.
And hope her and her family are doing well.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you so much,
Sinead.
Of course, editor from thejournal.ie has all of the up-to-date stories throughout the day and certainly keeping up to date with what's happening with Leo and Simon today. Thank you so much, Sinead O'Carroll. Cheers. Still to come this morning, our resident GP, Dr. Kiva Hartley, will be here to answer your questions. We know it's hard to get to a GP.
Yes.
It's not just going to be myself and Alan asking all the questions. So what do you want to ask her? 0896 111 111 if you've got a question regarding your health.
Plus, chic looks on the catwalk and celebrity conspiracy theories we're going to see very shortly.
Hello. Hello, good morning. Welcome back to Ireland AM.
Great to have you with us. Coming up very shortly, from nicotine pouches to speech fasting. So not talking for until what time?
12 o'clock.
12 o'clock. A lot of people watching this would love that. We are taking a closer look at the health headlines. Plus, Dr. Kiva Hartley is going to be answering your questions too. So if you do have any questions that you'd like to put to GP, 0896 111 111, send them in to us.
Yes, we'll be talking about that in just a little while at 8:45. Co-host of podcast The Creep Dive, which is all about...
Creeps.
It's not all about creeps. It's not about creepy people. It's just being a creep when you're like looking at things and dissecting things.
So you are the creep.
Doing a creep dive. You're the creep. Cassie Delaney talks all things celebrity conspiracy theories and separating fact from fiction.
There you go. Plus, they're heating things up with a heart-stopping live performance. There's Alan Hughes with the top off. The Magic Men Australia are teaching myself and Alan how to do backflips like that. With our tops on. That's going to be at 9:45. The Devon and Shane seen nothing yet. That's
we're not going Devonish. We're not going Devonish. Alan, darling.
What's Devonish?
Yeah, what's Devonish, Tommy?
Do you remember the Pleasure Boys, wasn't it, up in Belfast? That was all over social media.
Yeah, we won't be going there, I can guarantee you. Now, say goodbye to the hot girl summer and hello to the rich grandma look. And Mandy's here to tell us more.
So from one extreme to another is all I call this whole thing.
So strip us to a grandma.
For sure.
There we go.
So it's all about the grandma.
Are we not doing this justice? Because you see a lot of girls wearing, young girls wearing this look as well.
And that's exactly what we're showing.
It's going back to like the
morning.
Chanel type of look,
completely,
isn't it?
Completely, and that's exactly what we're showing this morning. Got four very similar styles this morning. And it is, and do you know what's great about these pieces is that they're wardrobe staples. Do you know the way sometimes you say there's different pieces you'd have in your wardrobe that are wardrobe staples? But this is definitely one of them. It's a piece you'll never get rid of.
Well, it's like even you could be passed down because it is inspired by the rich grandma
absolutely
look that you
sure
see in
is
America type thing.
It sure is, yeah. So looking forward to showing you what I have coming up later.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Some lovely looks coming up a little later on. Back over to you, Tommy.
Thank you very much.
I thought it was going to be Peg Sayers. You know, when I heard grandma, I was like, we're going full Peg Sayers today. Come on.
Looking forward to that, Mandy Maher. Thank you very much.
Time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We'll start with the Irish Times, the headline there. Harris considers €70 million boost for business. Plans to increase sick leave days could be paused and businesses could be in line for a €70 million tax boost as part of a package of supports promised by Taoiseach designate Simon Harris.
Be ready for an election, Harris tells internal Fine Gael committees. Simon Harris has asked party members for manifesto ideas to support farming and small businesses in a sign he is already gearing up for a general election, but insists it's not his intention to hold an election this year. That's the top story on the Daily Mail.
The Examiner's front page social media, a quote, health risk for young social social media use is creating broken people and it could be considered a public health risk, according to a stark warning from experts in psychiatry and the online sphere.
Fine Gael fears that moving McEntee will be seen as cave in to the far right. There are fears within the highest ranks of Fine Gael that moving Helen McEntee out of the Department of Justice could feed into the far right anti-immigrant agenda. That's the front page of the Irish Independent.
The Mirror goes with Puff the Magic Jacket. A young girl had a miraculous escape after she was washed into the sea at the height of Storm Kathleen. The seven-year-old who was walking along Dunleary Pier was saved when a capsule of air became trapped in her jacket, which kept her afloat.
Yes, the Herald also covers this incredible story. Their headline is Girl in Sea Saved by Her Puffer Jacket.
The Sun's front page, plucked from the jaws of death.
And finally, the Star leads with life jacket, hero volunteer dived in to save her. Andrew Sykes, who was on board the RNLI lifeboat involved in the rescue, entered the water to grab hold of the seven-year-old girl.
They got to her in just 6 minutes. Huge congratulations to the RNLI
group. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now, Virgin Media Television is delighted to announce our partnership with Darkness Into Light and Electric Ireland.
Yes, Darkness Into Light raises vital funds every year so that the charity Pieta can continue to deliver its nationwide suicide intervention and bereavement therapy. This annual campaign takes place on Saturday, 11th of May, and we are excited to be able to support it in a significant way.
Now, the funds raised from this year's Darkness Into Light will go directly to Pieta Services. So you can sign up at darknessintolight.ie to take part and raise funds for Pieta's life-saving work.
Really do incredible stuff. So please try and help out any way that you can. Now, we were speaking about a number of things this morning. One of the stories in making the news, you were talking about barriers facing people with disabilities.
Yeah, there's going to be a committee hearing later on today.
A committee hearing later on. And Angela just says, this is one of the things we were talking about earlier on. My son is visually impaired and uses a white cane. People parking cars on footpaths that we were talking about earlier on causes a big challenge to him every day. It's also very dangerous as he also often has to step out on busy roads to get past. Bins, overgrown hedges also can be a lot of harm and cause him some injuries every day. Just imagine out that when you come across a bin, but the cars, I suppose, if people, are they in areas that they need to park up on the path a little bit because the roads are too small or people can't get by?
But say it's someone, you're visually impaired and you know your way, right?
And then
you know
suddenly
your estate, but then someone
it.
Who comes in from the outside and they park up on the road. That's kind of, you know, there has to be.
And putting
something
a bin
there.
Out, just like I put my bin out and I never really think of it, but I'm in a sort of very small area where I don't think many people would pass
park
by.
Park up on the curb as well.
I know, I park in the car park.
Clodagh said, I was in a shop yesterday evening when a wheelchair user asked a staff member to open the toilets. The staff member replied, sorry, toilets close at 6 p.m. I was shocked and said, you have to open them. He went off, got the key. It took him 10 minutes to go off and get the key.
Isn't that just
customer
people,
service?
Not customer
like,
service.
A bit of customer
like somebody's
service,
in a wheelchair like. And you go, sorry, computer says no type thing, you know?
A message in here says, I'm a teenager with a physical disability. I face numerous issues on a daily basis. And I've noticed that most hotels in Ireland, while they have an accessible changing room, they don't have a hoist to help you get into a swimming pool.
So things that we wouldn't think
about. There is going to be a committee, an Oireachtas committee meeting on this today. On the challenges facing people with disabilities.
Keep your texts coming in. Thank you so much. I know we've got a lot of texts coming through for our next segment as well, because we are going to be speaking to GP Dr. Akiva Hartley. She's going to be answering your medical questions.
Talk to you in a minute.
Welcome back. Lots of health stories have been hitting the headlines recently, including Australia cracking down on influencers promoting nicotine pouches, and a new drug-free treatment for Alzheimer's is being tested in the UK.
Here to discuss is our resident GP, Dr. Akiva Hartley. Hello, good morning. Lovely to have you here. We've just all in the studio been talking about nicotine pouches. When I think of this, I think of a league of their own and them chewing the tobacco and spitting it. Is this what this is?
Similar, but no spitting. So they're small pre-filled microfiber pouches that contain nicotine, obviously, but don't contain tobacco. And they're placed between your cheek, your upper lip and your gum. And the nicotine then absorbs through the oral mucosa, which is the covering of the inside of your mouth. And the nicotine has an impact on our brain receptors. You release a lovely hormone called dopamine, and that gives you this lovely pleasurable response to using them. So that's
we have a picture
them.
Of it.
Okay, because that's interesting. That's what we were discussing there. Because I thought, and you hear the nickname snuzz or something as well, and you see people and they kind of have the lip.
Yeah.
You can see, but it's become very popular. I've seen a lot of people, even I know, who've been taking these.
Yeah.
So the damage to this, and Australia have actually gone and banned influencers and doing it, so they're obviously, and there's a big rise in this, and it's a big problem.
Yeah, they hit the UK market in 2019, so they're definitely around for a few years. They're growing in popularity, I think. People might use them as an alternative to something like vaping or smoking or that kind of thing, but the problem is we don't have great long-term health data, so we don't know the long-term implication of using them.
And it gives a high, isn't it? Kind of like a bit of a
dopamine, pleasurable response.
And it's like for a longer time or something. That's why they keep it up there for longer.
I guess so. And then there's no spitting or anything, which is, you know, nice, I guess. They do have side effects, though. So you can get irritated gums. You can get a sore mouth. You can get nausea. They are addictive because they contain nicotine.
Yeah.
You can get hiccups from them, weirdly enough, which was a weird side effect that I came across. I don't know why. But yeah, so they're around.
But there's no kind of, I suppose, you know, for parents who are watching right now, and you'd always be able to know when your young one was smoking because they'd stink, even though they put on the Lynx body spray. Like, these don't smell.
No, they don't. They come in these little sort of tins. They come in various doses. They can have flavourings, artificial sweeteners. They come in very bright, appealing packaging.
Okay. So it's like vaping.
A little bit, yeah. You'd wonder who they're really being marketed to, you know. And then, you know, if they're safer than smoking, that kind of thing, I'm not sure. Obviously, with no tobacco, they might be a little bit safer than smoking, but it is a bit like saying that's like half a parachute is safer than having a whole parachute. They're both bad options.
Yeah, and very, very addictive as well. We move on to another story. So this is very interesting. A new drug-free way of treating Alzheimer's has been developed.
Yeah, so this is based on research by a researcher called Annabelle Singer. So she's in the Emory Brain Health Center in Georgia. So what they did was they took a load of mice, they exposed them to flickering lights. So they flicker about 40 times a second.
So like and strobe lighting,
kind
is
of, I think, yeah. And then low-pitched sounds. So for an hour a day for 10 days. Then they reassessed the mice and they observed that the mice's memory was better. And so then the question is, can that be translatable then to people, to humans? So the human studies have started. You're laughing, but it's really good. It's brilliant to have like
those poor mice.
Oh, they've been
with
through
their
worse.
Better memories.
Better memories.
There you go.
So what do they remember where the cheese is next time for longer?
Do they put on a low beat like do they put on a low beat Maniac 2000 for them when the lights are going?
So that they feel
they're just raving.
I am laughing because these poor mice have to be subjected to this. But this is potentially, like, to treat Alzheimer's is incredible.
Well, having any option for something like a disease like Alzheimer's, which is so important. And dementia is so common. There's about 55,000 people living in Ireland with dementia.
Only rising, I gather, as
well. Because of our ageing population, it's going to become a much bigger issue. It's a social issue, not just a health issue. It affects not just the person with dementia, but people living with the person living with dementia. So the hope would be that this might be something we could offer. The human studies have started, or the trials for people have started, but are still really small. We don't have the data, etc.
Yeah. But any news is good news that could happen. Now we think
is there a time frame that something like this, a trial, could actually be put into place?
Years, I suppose. Years. Usually, to actually see an effect and for it to move through all the stages.
Okay.
The Alzheimer's Society of Ireland, just before I forget to mention, have their fundraising day on May 2nd, which is host a tea party day, and they have more information on their website.
Oh yeah,
with
lovely.
Flashing lights and low level music.
Maniac 2000. So this, we think this is a real story. Scottish singer Lulu, she's spoken about how she does speech fasting and doesn't speak until midday. Sure, if you're only getting up at 5 to 12, that's grand, isn't it? So is this a thing, speech fasting?
I don't know. I have some thoughts on this. So that this is a luxury that not everybody has. Like, I couldn't just decide to not speak until midday if I'm not sort of hollering in the morning. The kids won't be out the door with their socks and shoes on. So not everybody can just decide, I'm going to go mute for a few hours.
But if you're a singer and your vocal cords are very important, so it's like it's resting. It's like resting your muscles.
Yeah.
It's like I mean, Adele does it, Rod Stewart does it, Mariah Carey, well, she takes it to a different level. She sleeps in pretty much a steam room to try and help her vocal cords. But surely, if somebody
uses
their voice.
Yeah, I mean, for laryngitis and inflammation of your vocal cords, like, I can see, you know, obviously voice rest will help and your vocal cords will recover. So maybe if you're professional, but
for the rest of the world,
I just think sorry, it's really
lads,
difficult.
You're just going to have to have
but
a chat.
The world is noisy. Like, there's a lot of noise pollution out there. So maybe the less some people, myself included, speak, the better.
Wait a minute, girl. We'll be getting texts and going, you
and
too.
Us both.
You too could
We're
do
well used to that. Okay, let's move to a couple of the viewers' questions that you have coming in at the minute. Brian has sent in one saying, what can I do to minimise arthritis pain?
So that will depend on the type of arthritis. So arthritis is a kind of umbrella term. There's loads of different types of arthritis. There's osteoarthritis, which is kind of wear and tear type of arthritis. Mm-hmm. There's rheumatoid arthritis, which is an inflammatory type of arthritis. So there's loads of different types. So it depends on what's actually causing it. Typically, you know, go to your GP, figure out what type of arthritis you have. There's pain relief, analgesia.
What would be the most common?
Osteoarthritis, which is the wear and tear type of arthritis. And rheumatoid arthritis is next, I think. Physiotherapy. So exercise exercise that's supported by the input of someone like a physiotherapist or occupational therapist can be really helpful too.
Ursula says, can thyroid medication and HRT interact and have adverse effects? I assume this would a question that an awful lot of people would be interested in.
Yeah, because a lot of people are on thyroid replacement therapy. Because having an underactive thyroid gets more common as you get older. It's really common in women in particular. So oral estrogen, so estrogen in its tablet form, can definitely have an impact on thyroid medication and how much you need. Typically, though, we're prescribing estrogen through your skin. a patch, a gel or a spray. Yeah. And then that's not going to have an impact on your thyroid or how your thyroid functions or thyroid medication that you're taking.
So your doctor shouldn't be prescribing thyroid medication and an oral HRT?
They can, but they need to monitor it.
They need to monitor it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maria says, I have very dry skin and use steroid cream for eczema. I'm breastfeeding my 7-week-old. Are these safe to use while breastfeeding?
In small doses, they might be. I'd do that under the supervision of your GP. So you'd need to be assessed and need to see what other treatments you've tried. And is it definitely eczema that you're treating? That kind of thing. But so I would do that only with the supervision of your GP.
Okay. And a huge congratulations on your 7-week-old baby. Maybe, Maria. Hope it's going okay because eczema is obviously a huge issue.
Yeah.
And there's various, sometimes people aren't diagnosed properly with it.
That's true. Yeah, and things change with pregnancy and being postpartum and all of that can have an impact on your immune system and the development of things like eczema, yeah.
Brilliant. Absolutely fantastic.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kiva Hartley. Of course, if you do have any questions, go see your local GP and they will help you out the best that they can, as long as you can get in to see them, which we know is very difficult at the moment.
We're not going to ask you about that and what was happening at the conference, the Irish Medical Organisation conference last week. We'll be back with you on Ireland AM very shortly. Hello. Today we're turning to our grannies for fashion inspiration.
That's a bit mean.
I'm genuinely going through what my grandma used to wear, being the lovely house coat.
Stylist Mandy Marr is showing us how to achieve an old money look with some rich grandma aesthetic. But first, let's take a look at what it entails.
Like Lucille Bluth there from Arrested Development. We had Emily Gilmore from the Gilmore Girls. Gorgeous.
Yeah.
Gorgeous. Hi, Mandy.
Hi,
Mandy.
Good morning.
How are you?
Very excited about showcasing these pieces this morning for the simple reason is they're real classic pieces and pieces that go back probably to the 1960s, really, more onto the Chanel vibe of
the boucle jacket, like you're wearing today.
So. Billie Eilish at the Oscars really showed it up.
Yeah,
absolutely. She really did. And it's for all ages. You brought that point up earlier on, Alan. It is for all ages and all age groups. Obviously, it's that older vibe, but giving that real rich vibe at the same time, but not paying the rich prices, which is also very important.
Let's start with Michelle.
So we're heading for Friday's Edit, and Friday's Edit is an online company. And this, all of our looks this morning are very kind of probably slightly different, but this particular look is on the tweed side of that particular jacket that we showed earlier on screen. But I'm loving it as a great check. It's in the green. They also have this in a blue version as well. We could have closed it, but I wanted to keep it open for this morning just to style it slightly a little bit different.
Gorgeous. And then, sorry, I thought you were still going there.
Oh, you've just stopped there.
I was actually just going to let you get a word in edgeways with you, which is usually very unusual. But anyway.
It's going to be like going, Mandy malfunctioned? Do you normally
ever stop? For a change.
Underneath them, we've got a gorgeous cami.
We do indeed. We went with this lace camisole. And again, I'm loving the lace because to me, lace is a really old vibe, but yet always looks very chic and elegant at the same time.
Gorgeous.
And it's an oversized top, which I also quite like, particularly for somebody that wants to cover maybe a little bit of the tummy area. It's a great little number.
And then this kind of gorgeous white trousers.
Yeah, and these gorgeous. I'm loving these trousers. They're in a kind of probably like an off-white trousers, the wide leg, which we've been seeing quite a lot of, and a little bit shorter on the length. But also, Michelle, if I could just get you to pop up the top, there's like lovely little pocket details as well on these, or little buttons on the pockets. They are four pockets, by the way, just to mention that.
All right.
Lovely. Thank you very much.
Gorgeous. Look.
We're getting the idea then. So, exactly.
This is exactly the way it is. And what I also love, particularly about all the tops, they're great pieces for able to mix and match. I think that's what's important with the looks that we've shown this morning.
True.
And that's exactly with this look as well. We went with something different.
Dervla.
So we went with basically the waistcoat version of this, and it's probably more again onto the probably the tweed, more so the boucle. But I like this. There's a belt on it, but I actually tied the belt at the back and I've turned it open.
It's lovely.
So it just gave it more of a casual vibe. But obviously, it is a belt. It goes around the front, but I just felt open. It worked better with
it. But then you can make it more dressed up when you have it closed, wearing different trousers or a skirt, and it totally works. This is a casual look, yeah.
Exactly. Just simple t-shirt, then V-neck t-shirt underneath.
Hard to get. That looks like a really nice one because it's got a cap sleeve as well on the t-shirt. I really like that.
And it's a really great quality as well. It's actually really lovely. And again, they have them in a variety of colours. And it's the full look, actually, just to mention, it is from Friday's edit. But I love the trousers in these.
And it is the same ones that we had in white with the faux pockets.
Exactly, Alan, well spotted. This is exactly the navy version. It has the faux pocket with the button detail. But again, they're very elegant, very dressy, I think.
But a harder wearing material.
They are. They're slightly little bit heavier, yes.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
Very nice.
Beautiful.
Indeed.
Gorgeous.
And
look,
I can
there.
See that when you do close that, it becomes totally different.
It's a completely different look, but I just preferred it open with what it was on this morning.
Now, this is sort of the Chanel look that people know about.
It absolutely is. And this full look is actually from River Island in the Athlone Town Centre. But I'm loving this. And we were saying about pieces in your wardrobe. And I'm like myself, if it stood long enough, I'd have you in the bin, because I'm deadly for not holding pieces. But there are certain pieces I definitely do love, and this is one of them.
Yeah, it's fun.
It's a real sustainable piece. It is a beautiful check, very, very elegant. And it's really inspired, as we do know, by the Chanel inspiration. But I'm loving the beautiful gold button details.
And they've had that jacket in a red, in a navy. They're doing it in loads of different styles, jacket, different colours.
They absolutely do, and I love it.
Plain black top underneath it.
We did, Alan. We just went with a simple satin top, and this is what I'm loving about this. This is a satin top and trousers. They have this in a dress. They also have it in the skirt. But what I like about the satin and the mixture of this with the jacket is the fact that different textures, and it's important that you can mix and match with textures.
Different textures.
Between the jacket and the actual top and trousers,
I see
it's good
to
mix
it
with the satin.
Gorgeous.
And it's really, really elegant. And we finished off then simple with a simple chain and bracelet.
And then the sunglasses, the oversized sunglasses.
Yeah, they always give that rich vibe.
I love those sunglasses.
Aren't they gorgeous?
They're great.
I'm loving them. And they're the cat eye version, and I'm loving them. I think they're really elegant. Definitely a statement piece. And I love glasses on you. I think glasses are definitely an all year round.
They're lovely.
Regardless of the weather.
Maria, they were made for you. Absolutely gorgeous.
And the chain and bracelet really sets it off.
It does, Alan. Yes, absolutely. Like, if you want to, you could easily layer lots of jewellery with these particular looks. I did them this morning, but you can easily as well.
It's a Monday morning. You're all right.
No, thanks.
Fine, don't worry about it.
Thanks.
And Michelle is back for our final look
today. And for our final look today, then, it's from Zara at the Athlone Town Centre as well. And this is
it's lovely.
This is gorgeous.
Yeah.
I'm loving this as well. It's absolutely beautiful. It is the boudoir materials, and it also has great sparkle. And you could easily wear this. I think this could be gorgeous with an over dress as well if you wanted to.
Lovely, but it's got
a long
real
skirt.
Absolutely,
skirt.
Alan.
Real communion day vibes, doesn't it?
Isn't it? Mm. Absolutely. I'm loving it. It's very chic, very rich looking. And this is what it's all about with these looks. They're for all ages. So you don't pigeonhole this type of styling. It's very much on trend for the season as well, for the summer coming through to the summer.
The baby blue trousers are lovely.
Aren't they fabulous?
Yeah.
And again, like that, Zara are always great, to be fair, when it comes to their trousers. They're a great quality. They have them in a variety of colours. They're high waisted, and again, what I'm loving about pieces like this is that it's about thinking outside the box. Can you wear this during the daytime? Yes, you can. Can you wear it at night going out? Yes, you can. And that's what we want to do with our wardrobes.
And that kind of jacket, now you will have that for years.
Isn't it? Yeah, absolutely. That's what I'm saying about the piece. You'll always have them.
And the little clutch.
And just went with a simple silver clutch. Then the clutch bag itself then is from Shoelace, which is in another shop that's in the Athlone Town Centre. There is a little chain inside, but we kept it as a clutch this morning.
Gorgeous, Michelle. That is a lovely look on you. Thank you so much, and yourself as well. Mandy, you're living it.
Well, mine is a dress this morning, but I didn't want to go viral for the wrong reason, so hence I left on the jeans.
I wish, go on.
It's a little bit on the short side, I think, for TV on a Monday morning. So
we've got Magic Mike coming in
I could be in the middle of it.
You can do that later on. So,
but thank you both this morning. But it's about inspiring that real old look, bringing it through now, and it's for all ages, as we say. So
gorgeous. Yeah, thank you so much, as always, Mandy.
Thank you.
Now up next, we're tackling the good, the bad and the downright unbelievable when it comes to celebrity conspiracy theories.
We'll talk to you very shortly on Ireland AM. Welcome back. Now, we've all seen how fast celebrity conspiracy theories can take off, especially with, we'll say, the huge speculation we were doing it here around Kate Middleton's absence from the public eye recently.
Yes, one of many stories we do here is to talk more about celebrity conspiracy theories is podcaster Cassie Delaney. Good morning to you.
Hi. Morning, Cassie.
Cassie, I just think we're hearing so much more about this with social media and everything else, these conspiracy theories. So you've done a podcast on it, The Creep Dive.
Yeah, so we've done The Creep Dive for years and we talk about anything and everything. So recently we've been talking a lot about celebrity conspiracy theories because they're so popular.
Yeah.
They're everywhere. Like, you could literally Google a celebrity's name and conspiracy theory and find something mad and mental about them.
Is it getting to the stage where people are just making stuff up, like, and just because they know it'll take off and put it on TikTok,
yeah,
couple of videos?
Yeah,
and...
I mean, there's loads of reasons why they take off. You know, you have to look at the way information is spread now. Like, anyone is a publisher. So anyone can pick up their phone, create some sort of like viral content, and then they feel part of something and they're getting that boost, that ego boost from their content doing well. And like, you know, there's just communities and communities of people on TikTok. You can go viral very, very quickly with it. So yeah, it's spreading for, I mean, a ton of different reasons. And a lot of them are just fun. A lot of them are kind of, you know, they start funny, but some of them start from either like people connected to celebrities and stuff, and then they just spread like wildfire.
Are there any repercussions for people who are just starting off a rumor just for the sake of
it? I mean, yeah, like, you've got defamation laws and you've got certain, you know,
but on social media, not really,
you know, not massively. I haven't seen anybody massively been taken down because they've been spreading lies about Beyonce on the internet.
Exactly. Okay. See, this is what happens. And we live in a world of things like Dumois, which is a big celebrity website you have discussed on The Creep Dive many a time. It's yourself, Sophie White and Jen, you sit down and you have chats about this. So before we would have had JFK, conspiracy theory. Mm-hmm. Everyone knew about that for years. Elvis, Jim Morrison still alive, Tupac.
Yeah.
These were like the main conspiracy theories, but there was only a few of them. Now it's happening all the time. So let's go into what happened with Kate Middleton, because that has made us take a long, hard look at ourselves.
Yeah, I mean, there's like a load of reasons why you have to look at the royals and why that was so funny and so popular. First of all, the royals are this kind of like media machine, and they really messed up here with the Kate Middleton story. When they put out the statement that she was an amateur, you know, photographer messing around with Photoshop, that was just so bizarre to people. So what really happened was, obviously, she was away taking treatment. She hadn't been seen in the public eye for a really long time. So people started speculating about where she was. There was lots of thoughts about an affair, you know, that they were going to get divorced, all this kind of thing, which is just normal speculation for the royals. But then it took on this other life when people were like, she's on The Masked Singer, she's away doing this. Like, they became very, very funny. So it was one of those things that spiraled and spiraled and spiraled. And the more people were talking about it, the more theories people were coming up with, the funnier they became, you know, the more ego boosts there were there for people. So it was like, hard to contain.
It became huge. Some of the stories, I was saying, this is the truth, this is gospel, it's heard. But do you think that the royals played it badly, or do you think they played it quite well in the fact that, like, all these conspiracies were going, people were going out of control with some of the things, but actually whenever they came out and Kate revealed about her cancer diagnosis, it made people really feel bad and think that, you know what, maybe we do need to second guess.
Yeah,
I mean, I think it put to bed maybe a lot of the rumors that were out there.
Yeah, I think that they could have come out a lot earlier to release a statement and say it's a family issue, she needs private space. They really didn't do anything to help themselves when they released the photo of the kids, you know. And then you had Getty Images having to come out and say this photo looks like it's manipulated before the royals got ahead of it.
Maybe
and
it was Kate. Maybe it was her photoshopping.
But the fact that it was a photoshopping.
She did say she was.
I mean, I think so, but it just, the idea of Kate Middleton sitting down with Photoshop on her phone and like face tuning her kids.
But she obviously was.
I don't know.
I mean, she obviously was, if that's what she said, and then.
Well, making her take the blame for that was something else.
Yeah, I think they could have dealt with it a lot more proactively.
But even that, the fact that she didn't say some of these, you have to say, if you have manipulated an image for things like the Press Association and Getty, you have to say this has been manipulated because we're living in this world. So you have to state it these days. They didn't do that. Scoop is out at the minute about another royal scandal, we'll say, with Prince Andrew. Mm-hmm. And there's this big thing in it about never complain, never explain. Right. Yeah. So if you don't say anything, you'll never have to explain for your actions, because we live in this world. Social media, that is not a thing anymore.
No.
That is gone. So if you don't say something, is it just going to be a rush with conspiracy theories from now on?
Yeah, essentially, like, people like to fill in the silences and they like to fill in the gaps, and people love to speculate, you know? And the thing is, when you look at celebrity conspiracy theories as well, you have to acknowledge something like the Free Britney movement for a couple of years ago, because what started as a very bizarre conspiracy that Britney was somehow being held against her will or not able to operate in the world the way that she should turned out to be true. So now everyone is trying to get the next big scoop and trying to figure out where celebrities
are
being...
for the better, though? And then I know that whole Free Britney movement came out with the conservatorship or whatever else, but someone would say that maybe nowadays her without that conservatorship, maybe she was being protected. Would that not be...
As in she was being protected by the conservatorship?
By her family, that were trying to look out for her, because, like, she does, at the moment, if you follow her social media...
Need some...
help, potentially.
Yeah, she does. Yeah, I mean, there's an argument for and against it. I mean, she said herself it was against her will. So, I mean, you have to allow people to advocate for themselves and make their own decisions. Should her phone be taken off her? I think so. But, you know, it's not for us to say what care an adult woman needs.
Again, and to be, you know, drugged without her consent, to not be under proper care of doctors. Like, there was a lot going on there. So that was the conservatorship, which started off as a conspiracy theory, the Free Britney movement. It turned out to be real.
Yeah.
So this is where things can happen. But we're living in a world of deep fakes, and we're living in a world where we don't know what's real and what isn't real. Beyonce, there's stuff going on with Beyonce?
Oh, yeah. So this is an interesting one, because this came from someone who worked in Columbia Records, who said that she had seen Beyonce's driver's license on a computer on her boss's desk, and that Beyonce is actually born in 1974 and not 1981, because Solange is her daughter. She had a teen pregnancy. Her parents stepped in, adopted Solange, and then they, you know, shaved a few years off Beyonce's life so that she could have this great global success. Now, obviously, it's just that that came from someone who said she knew her, so it had an air of authenticity in it. But then Gabrielle Union came out and she was like, I was friends with Beyonce when we were teenagers. Now she's like 10 years older than her, so everyone's like, you can't have been teenagers at the same time. So they just, you know, like, they just take on these mad...
So hold on, Cassie Delaney from The Creep Dive, are you saying Beyonce is 10 years older? Well, are you saying that she's...
never crossed
7 years older,
like,
never.
I would never say anything publicly about Beyonce there for or against, because I am terrified of these communities of people.
Because this is the thing, even like in a podcast based in Ireland, but you've got fans all over the world, you know, it's an incredibly popular podcast. The fact is, these stans, so the Beehive, the Swifties, they're incredibly powerful and they go at each other. So we'll say the Selena Gomez tribe against the Hailey Bieber tribe. And they're making things up about each other all the time.
Absolutely. Like, you cannot say anything against Taylor Swift, Beyonce, any, like, the
but
female
But is that good
stars.
Then? So... that could be the truth, but you can't say it because the Beehive will come after you.
I'm not going to say it now on the telly channel. Okay. I don't want you guys to get sued by Beyonce's people.
Okay, let's hope at Elvis then. Is he still alive?
Elvis is obviously like the main source of potentially every conspiracy theory, because it goes way back to him, that he faked his own death in, what it was, at 1974. Yeah. He didn't really die on the toilet. And he the rumour is that he is a singing pastor in Arkansas called Bob Joyce. Now, they look incredibly similar. The singing pastor sounds like Elvis.
Do you know what? We actually have a clip of him.
Oh,
let's
great.
Take a look.
Islands in the Stream.
The king,
that's how you're starting these conspiracy theories now.
The king is alive.
Yeah.
And he's singing.
He's singing.
I mean,
still got a hell of a voice
and
a lovely beard.
You'd fake your death too when you got bored.
That's
what
you need to do. You can listen to The Creep Dive with fabulous Cassie, Sophie and Jen anywhere where you get your podcast. And my God, do they go deep into these conspiracy theories. It's great fun. Cassie Delaney, thank you so much
for
joining
you.
Us. Lovely to
thank
have you here.
Thank you, Cassie.
Coming up in the final hour of Ireland AM, Fair City's Mondo, aka George McMahon, will be giving us a look behind his life behind the screen. I can't say words. Sorry, I'm still up with the pastor.
Australia's hottest dance troupe, yes, the cast of Magic Men, are going to be here in the studio, and they're going to be showing myself and Alan some magic moves. Step aside, Channing Tatum. Get ready for that. That's all coming up in the final hour.
Here. She can't believe this is happening. are very welcome back to Ireland AM. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Coming up very shortly, spent the last 20 years on our TV screens, Fair City's George McMahon will be telling us about life beyond Carrickstown and why he's trying to inspire the next generation.
And Alan, I have never seen him do so much research for a piece in my entire life. He has been on Instagram.
Alan and research don't
he was
go
sitting there going, now
normally.
I saw on the 3rd of May 2020, they did this. Alan, what's coming up?
I did go on my Instagram yesterday to have a look. Yeah. So now we're getting a bit steamy in the studio this morning. So if there's any little ears there who are listening, maybe put them on the iPad for a little bit, because we've got Australia's answer to Magic Mike, the Magic Man. Well, good morning to you.
Good morning.
How are you?
Very well, thank you. How are you?
So big gig tonight and tomorrow night here in Dublin.
Yep, Civic Theatre tonight and tomorrow night. It's
and I'm just looking at you, and who do you remind me of now? Who is it? Channing, what's that guy's name?
I don't know, I can't think. I can't think of that guy's
name. Channing Tatum, yeah.
Who's that?
I mean, you look at you there and look at that. Look at that. That is uncanny.
Oh, wow, Catherine.
I mean, you must get it all the time, but you don't mind it.
A little bit. I'm like that guy who looks like Channing Tatum now.
Yeah. But I was watching your Instagram. You milk that
You've
as
done
well.
Your research. You've done your research, haven't you?
You've been doing it. And I love that it's the looks into the camera. Go on, give us a close-up there. Go on, lads. You have to get a close-up there. Look.
There we go.
Oh, look at this. Oh, it's a bit shiny. Listen,
you're making me blush.
I don't think so. You're going to be showing me and Tommy some moves a little later on.
That's it. Are you ready for some body rolls?
What are they called?
Rolls. Yeah. Are you going to get the abs out?
Oh, we might a little later on. We'll find out. Looking forward to that. That's coming up. And you know who's very excited? Our chef this morning, Catherine Layden.
She's
very excited that you're in this morning.
And that's just seeing you doing a few body rolls, Alan. I nearly needed the bucket myself. Catherine, what did you make of that? Looking forward
God
to the Magic Men.
God between us and all arms, what you say?
Were you a fan of Magic Mike, the movie? Did you ever watch it?
Never heard it.
Okay, well, listen, you're not on till 8:30, so you can go or 9.
Half
you
9.
Can check it out. What are we having in the kitchen this
We're
morning?
We're having a very basic scone or scone.
Okay.
Right? But there are a few important, very important tips to get a nice light while there isn't scone.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Well, after those lads do their dance, we'll all be scone. Right.
Welcome back. We were talking earlier on about the Oireachtas committee that's taking place to discuss the lack of facilities for people who have disabilities or how hard it is to go about everyday life.
And lots of you have been getting in touch. We were talking about wheelchair access. And Carol says, my husband has prostate cancer and the lack of bathroom facilities is shocking. I've only become aware of this since his diagnosis. And I suppose if you are in city centres or in towns, the days of the public toilets are definitely gone. So you're actually trying to find something and somewhere, and you might want to go into a cafe or somewhere and they say no customers only, and you'll see it on the doors and stuff. And I know a friend of mine who ran a cafe in Dublin said that they literally had to be so strict for her because the amount of drug users who were going in, and they were finding that, and then they had to put ultraviolet lights in the bathroom so they wouldn't see their veins and all the stuff they had to go through. Yeah.
Jeez. Yeah. Really?
Yeah. Is that why they've gotten rid of so many public toilet facilities?
I think they were just became a haven for that type of thing.
Because I remember in Galway, they had them in Air Square and it was an automatic door.
Oh, yeah, and then it washed itself.
Then the automatic door would open at inopportune moments. Just
the
tell you.
Problem with that exactly?
If anyone's seen too much of me,
button.
It was definitely from the toilets in Air Square.
What happened? Did you not press the lock button?
I did press the lock button.
And why did it open?
It was open. Oh. I was like, what's happening?
But were they the ones that then when they opened, they washed themselves? Like
I was just worrying. Got the fright. That's it, yeah. Because you know, isn't it like the toilets in the train
or
whatever?
And the train, you have to press
the lock button, and you know, people who don't know how to do that, and then you press the button to open
it. And it opens up, you're like, hello.
It's like last week here, Tommy.
Huh? Oh, yeah, exactly. Walking in on me. Rachel said, my son is a wheelchair user and there are issues such as dog dirt on the path. That's brutal. That is brutal, and of course, people parking directly behind the car, oblivious to the sign in the rear window, asking them to give 3 metres to let the car out, the door open.
They can't open it then because the car
So it's just, of course, it's being more mindful. And if you are walking the bloody dog, go and pick up after you. It wrecks my head, that does.
And where you're putting your bins. And if you have an overhanging hedge, maybe just cut it back a little bit, because I don't. Don't just, be looking at me.
Just about to say, he's going to be out with the chainsaw later on. Is that how you cut a hedge? Is it?
This is how I cut my hedge.
He's excellent in a game of charades.
I say to the birds, cut the hedge like that.
Thank you for sending those texts on that, because I think it is something people out there with disabilities really struggle with. And you forget about it. Like, you don't even
100%.
Like what people are having to deal with.
And we're
going to
talk about it again, hopefully, once we get some recommendations from this committee to see what's going on for.
And we're not
going to
start on the nicotine patches, because Catherine Layden's been asking us all about it. She's over going, what's that about now? Can I
thumbs
get
up.
Them here?
Thank you for your text.
Thank you for your text. Now, up next, from screen drama to off-screen romance, we're going to be catching up with Fair City's Mondo. We all know him. George.
We'll talk to him after the break.
Welcome back. Even our next guest is one of the most familiar faces in Carrickstown, and he's stopped by for a catch-up.
He sure has. Actor George McMahon joins us to chat Fair City family life and fatherhood. Good morning to you, Mondo. What's a crack?
It's good, because I was getting my makeup done this morning, and she's like, well, what are you chatting about this morning? And I was like, I actually forget.
So I don't know what we're doing.
We're going to chat.
We never really know ourselves. We just see where it takes us.
Freewheeled this morning,
And you were telling us some stuff that we're going to have to get to later on in the chat as well. We're looking forward to that. Talk to us about Fair City, though. 22 years chatting Mondo stories, storylines. I mean, it is insane.
Yeah, it's mad. I still feel like one of the newbies in there, which is kind of weird. You've not been there 22 years. And when you say 22 years, it just, you know, it makes me feel really, really old.
But you were in at such a young age, and everyone knows Mondo.
Yeah.
Like, everyone does know Mondo.
Yeah, I suppose they know. I don't know if it's the ridiculous name as well, like a Mondo. You know what I mean?
It works.
It works, and it's definitely stuck. It's stuck.
Because it did put you into people's, like, you know, even if someone was doing a skit on Fair City, you were always involved because of the name.
Because of the name, yeah.
Like, it really did. Yeah, it got you into people's heads very quickly.
Yeah, I think Paddy Power had odds on who was going to be the next Ireland boss. The FAI, and I think Mondo was 8-1. Mondo from Fair City was 8-1. So yeah,
Mondo up there with Roy Keane. Exactly. Yeah.
That'd be amazing.
I haven't said no to the job just yet.
To be fair, Mondo has a right chance, because it doesn't look like anyone else is taking it.
Yeah, yeah.
We could be waiting a long time.
It'd be a great Fair City storyline.
I mean,
although you'd have to give, because Ken Barlow, I think he's the longest running person on soaps. I mean,
yeah. Well, that man is in his 90s, you know?
He's 92 years old.
Oh, yeah, okay, there you go.
He's
92 years old.
Yeah.
Wow. And he's still in Coronation Street.
And so you're saying there's a chance. There.
Yeah, that's a great photograph of him there. So look, if I'm still around in my 90s, I'd be delighted. But I'm not too sure that people are going to be watching TV the way they used to back in the day. They'll be all watching Ireland.
George,
sure.
Let's keep this alive, man.
Is it something you discuss that?
So do I?
Like, the way the world is going and Fair City and everything, trying to evolve it for, like, obviously you have to evolve for kind of more current themes.
Yeah,
and
probably
stuff,
for attention spans as well. Do you know what I mean? I think we're going to have shorter episodes, I think, you know, like in years and years to come. I think, you know, there was even talk of, like, I think even the BBC were talking about their player, that if you just, if you had your favourite storyline, that you just followed that storyline.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, yes, there's loads of
That's
ways.
Interesting.
I think. Shorts.
But you do a lot in one episode. Mm-hmm. Like, when I'm sitting down watching Fair City, I'm like, hold on, what's happening now? Because that was there, and like, some storylines can go for almost a year.
Yeah, they're the long burner ones.
You're
like,
are they still in the box? What's happening? Or what's
still
going
in the
on?
Box, yeah. Katie.
Katie.
She got out of the box, after a good year there.
A year?
Yeah.
Like, I was just sitting there talking to poor Johnny, going, she's still in the box. Like, how are you? Like, but everyone was following that.
I know, they wanted to know, was she going to get it? It was like Gilligan's Island, you know, were they going to, is she going to, are they going to.
But is that a big thing for ye as actors to go, are we going to get the long storyline? Are we going to get the Katie in the box storyline? Because there's got to be competition for
that. Absolutely. Well, I mean, there's 40 or 50 actors, you know, on the books there. You can't be in all the stories all the time. So, you know, when you get availability checked for a good run of weeks, then you kind of go, oh, lovely, there's a nice little bit of story coming up. So that can be exciting. And if you're there for a long time, you can't be in all the stories all the time. So you learn to understand that. But then, you know, when the scripts start coming in, and then you've got a pile of scenes, you're like, lovely.
See, you have no
idea. So is there a bit of a competitiveness?
I don't think there's a competitiveness. Of course you do, yeah. Some weeks they'd be happy enough just to have a few scenes in the week. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? But as an actor, I think you want to scratch that itch. You want to be as creative as possible. You want to be telling as much stories as possible. So, you know, you're ready and you're poised. Yeah. Good to go.
There has to be a bit of paranoia about that then, though. Is it like, am I not the flavour of the month at the minute? Like, I can just imagine it can be kind of a tough space to be in.
Yeah, I suppose. I think your natural disposition as an actor is that you're insecure anyway. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I suppose that's one of the good things of having, you know, 22 years of experience. You get to understand that actually it's just your turn this time, you know?
It's very interesting. Something I never even thought about exactly is you're just... on the end of where the writers are thinking, and you have no real say in it. And talk to me about yourself, your wife Rachel as well.
Yeah.
Because you weren't sure what way she was thinking initially as well. How did you get together?
So I was kind of she friend zoned me. We know each other a very long time.
Friend zone. How the hell did you get out of the friend zone? That's like an episode of Fair City in itself.
It's a thing that they say that you never get out of. But if I would say to anybody, if you are in the friend zone now, persistence is key. So it took me 12 years. So eventually I broke her.
Stop it. Don't be saying that. You were good friends and then it blossomed.
Absolutely, yeah. And then we built a beautiful relationship on that foundation.
Exactly, which is a gorgeous, gorgeous thing. But she was going out with someone who is in the Magic Mike show.
Hang on, this was not for this is actually not for public consumption.
Sorry.
Man, that's a yellow card.
When I really said, you never know where this chat could go.
Yeah, well, anyway, there you go. So she downgraded. I'm sorry, Rachel, you're stuck with me. I'm no Magic Mike, but I have a great personality.
And he's going to put on a performance for you later on.
No, they're all going to have. Not, no, I was going to. No, I'm not.
They're all shouting in our ear going, Magic Mondo, Magic.
He's got the zip up top now. We're going to have the abs ready to go. We'll get baby oil out.
Rachel's a dancer. You've got a school together. You do a drama school,
yes,
right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. So we run Glitz Stage Academy. We have a new term starting today, by the way. I'm going to get a plug in now because of that.
Well
now.
Done.
New terms today starting in Knoll in the Seamus Ennis Arts Centre. We'd love to see some new faces. Magic Mikes, Magic Mandys, whoever you are, come and join us. It'll be great.
And is it singing, dancing, acting, the whole lot?
The whole lot. What's her age? Dancing, acting, and we start from 3 and we have them right up to 18 years of age.
3?
Yep, 3.
Because, to be fair to Irish acting and like the stars at the minute, like, I'd say there's a huge boom in it and a lot of parents and a lot of kids
seeing
the Paul Mescals and the Katrina Balz and all these amazing actors. I'd say there's huge interest.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it seems to be a much smaller world now. You don't have to travel to LA to audition for Hollywood. You know, you can do a self-tape in your bedroom and send it off to casting directors and you can be discovered literally from the comfort of your own home.
But I suppose when you're thinking like Matilda was an Irish, you know, an Irish girl and to see the revere she's held in by an awful lot of stage girls. She's such a lovely,
lovely
person.
Yeah, she's great. She's brilliant.
Isn't she fab?
Yeah.
Because it was always like the Billy Barry kids that we saw on the toy show.
Yeah, that's
And they were held in this high esteem. Yeah. Everyone wanted to be able to get
that's
in. And
right.
Does it feel more open now for kids to kind of do more
stuff? It's not the closed shop that it once was. You know what I mean? Growing up, it was anyone who was in Hollywood, it was Colin Farrell. You know what I mean? And it seemed, you know, otherworldly or unattainable. But now it's just the floodgates have opened. We've Paul Mescal, we've got Barry Keoghan, you know. It used to be kind of an elitist kind of a thing that people, you know, posh people go to RADA and then they become stars. But now it's anybody. And I think that's great. It's just opened it up and it's made it more achievable. And that's why more and more kids are showing more interest.
Can
in
you
it
spot
well.
A real star from the get-go?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think you can. I think kids have some kids have just something special
something
about them. Whether it's being a convincing performer or just having the chat and there's a bit of spark about them, I think you can.
But there's so obviously we're putting at the very top Oscars here, but there's actually such an industry that people can make a living in any amount of different fields in this as well. So if they get into singing or dancing or acting, there's just such an opportunity.
Yeah,
out there.
Absolutely, and that's what I'd say to anybody who's an aspiring actor. You know, like. you know, 90% of, you know, 99% of actors don't make money just from acting alone. They always have a side hustle.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So, like, and there's loads of side hustles you can have as an actor. There's teaching, there's voiceovers, there's loads of different things. So it's, yeah, so it's wide open.
It's really interesting because there's a report in the paper today about children and that it could be seen, like, from psychiatrists saying that the social media is, it's a real worry, like, that this is going to be a very hard thing. When you're going out there performing, if you've got a love of something that you're doing with people, like, I'm assuming, like, Frankie, your daughter, she does all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's good for integration and
it's to kind of be skills, chatting.
Social
it's confidence,
skills.
It's stuff that we take for granted. It's being able to stand up in a room full of people and speak. Oh, there she is there, yeah. Like, butter wouldn't melt.
I know.
Isn't she fabulous?
What age is she now?
She's going to be 6 next month.
Wow.
Yeah, and she's absolutely wild. She has our, we have our work cut out for ourselves, but she's great fun.
Is she a dancer, a singer? Is she?
She's all of the above.
Is she?
Yeah, we get a nightly panto off her every night. She's like, okay, boys and girls, my name is Olivia. She makes herself, she's Olivia, and she's like, today we're going to do a panto, and she stands at the fireplace and does a full performance every night. And we'd be wrecked, and we'd be like, it's bedtime. It's like, no, we can't go to bed until the panto happens.
I believe as a dad, you're stricter than Rachel then as well, is that right?
Yeah, I'd be the bad cop, yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm wasting my time because both the kids look at me and they think I'm an idiot.
Exactly.
I have actually no respect in the house at all. Nobody respects me, so there's no point
girls ganging up. Well, it's actually, no, you have a little fella as well.
Yeah, that's Cody there as well, yeah. He's a little bit softer, but neither of them listen to me at all. So I'm wasting my time being the bad cop.
Well, my
Rachel
kids are a year too
old. Rachel has it sorted,
it's the exact same, to be honest.
As long as Rachel has it sorted.
Yeah.
Sorry, Rachel. George McMahon, it's a pleasure to see you. Ireland captain next.
Ireland manager, yeah.
Ireland manager next.
Yeah. Hey, what's the name of the stage school?
It's Glitz Stage Academy.
Glitz Stage Academy, amazing. Very good. I'm sure lots of kids will be sending, or parents will be sending the kids down there this summer as well. I'm so sorry.
We shouldn't be allowed to talk to people before we go live on television.
Absolutely. We're going to have Magic Mondo coming up at 9.45 today. You'll want to stay to watch. Oh, there he is. He's stretching. Still to come, things are heating up in the studio and it's not Mondo, it's Catherine Layden is in the kitchen.
What is she doing in the kitchen? We'll talk to you in a minute. We're really ramping this up now, aren't we?
Welcome back. Let's take a look at the headlines now. And Leo Varadkar will carry out his final engagement as Taoiseach today when he attends a meeting of the North-South Ministerial Council in Armagh. Afterwards, he'll return to Dublin where he's due to resign from his role officially at OSN Uachtaráin this evening. The new Fine Gael leader, Simon Harris, is expected to become Taoiseach when the dole resumes after its Easter break tomorrow. Israel has said it's reducing its number of soldiers in southern Gaza because the military has completed its mission in the city of Khan Yunis. But it is warning a significant force would remain in Gaza. Israel and Hamas have both sent delegations to Cairo for fresh ceasefire talks 6 months into the war. Meanwhile, Trocar's CEO has described the conflict as a war on children. And the funeral takes place today of Sarah McNally, the Longford woman who was stabbed to death in New York last week. The 41-year-old was working at the Cayley House pub in Queens when the incident happened. Sarah's funeral mass is due to be held at 11 o'clock this morning in St. Mel's Cathedral in Longford and will be followed by a private cremation. A man has appeared in court in New York, charged in connection with her death. Time now for a final look at the weather.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
This morning will be rather cold with outbreaks of mostly light rain continuing to spread north and west across the country. Highest temperatures of 6 to 8 degrees. Moving on to this afternoon, and areas of moderate to heavy rain are likely across Leinster and southern Munster, leading to a threat of flooding there. Highest temperatures of 7 to 10 degrees. And tonight, showery rain will continue to affect the east coast. Elsewhere will be largely dry, with cloud cover breaking up and clearer spells developing more widely. Minimum temperatures of 6 to 8 degrees.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Thanks for staying with us. Now, do you know, sometimes you just can't beat the classics. And today we've one of our favourites.
Absolutely. Whatever about the food, it is Catherine Layden, our favourite. Good morning to you, Catherine.
Good morning.
And I love whenever you come in now and make the, some it's of the classics.
The classics.
And scones.
Scones, you can't beat them. Or scones, depends where you went to school. I call them scones. What do you call them?
Always scones.
I'm a scone.
Are you a scone? Yeah, there's a scone. Difference.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that posh now or what?
Scotland's the not posh way of saying it.
Take them out of the oven.
Scone is posh.
Turn them onto a clean tea towel.
I'm sorry, we're getting going.
Okay.
They're done. Thanks very much. Here. There you go.
Into a clean tea towel and leave them to cool down a bit. Right?
Why the tea towel? What does the tea towel do?
Soften the crust.
Oh, does it?
Okay. Now, to make Now, a basic scone, we're going to make a basic one now, but there are lots of variations you can add to it.
Right.
And nowadays, I find they're making these massive, awful, rock-hard buns in cafes and restaurants.
And they've all the sugar on top of it and all.
Brutal.
Yeah.
Now, make them at home yourself far easier. 225 grams, 8 ounces of our self-raising flour.
So this is plain scone then?
Plain scone, yeah.
Do you think the tray bakes nowadays in cafes and stuff aren't what they used to be? They're all mass-produced.
They are. And they're made of mixes.
Yeah.
And a lot of the scone or scone mixes, you have to leave them to sit. And that means the air is coming out of the dough. They're very tight, they're very heavy.
They all fall apart.
And they all fall apart. You should never have to cut a scone, as hopefully we won't have here. You're supposed to just break it and butter it.
I agree, yeah, exactly. Yeah. I never get a scone now when I'm in a cafe anymore.
Oh no, they're desperate things altogether, yep.
Yeah.
50 grams.
Tommy Bowe's spoken.
2 ounces of caster sugar.
I'll be stopping in the cafe and it'll be told off. Yeah.
You said our scones are rubbish, get out.
Pinch of salt. So in there now we have the flour. What else should I put in? The salt. Now, even though we're using self-raising flour, I'm adding just a good pinch of baking powder to get a nice lift on the scones.
Okay.
Now, to that, I'm going to add 1 ounce. You could go up to 2 ounces of butter or margarine. Now, your scone will be lighter if you use margarine. Or indeed, in the old days, they used what they called shortening. Like fat, basically.
Oh, right.
But I prefer the taste of the butter.
Butter, yeah.
And now, is that room temperature butter, that one now?
Room temperature butter, Tommy.
Are you using the butter?
I'm using the butter.
Oh, you're using
the butter. Yeah, yeah. I prefer it for taste. Now, with scones, first of all, it's important that you sieve the flour as I did. Secondly, the less handling the dough gets, the better. So, tips of your fingers and rub. Now, quick tip. It makes extra work, but if you use a food processor, put your flour into the food processor, add your 1 or 2 ounces of butter, frozen if possible, give it a quick buzz, 20 seconds, out into the bowl and add your milk.
Okay.
Much quicker, but you've got an awful job cleaning the bowl afterwards. That's the problem. Okay. Now, to that we're going. Now, you could add an egg and reduce some of the milk, but I'm just using an ordinary basic scone mixture. And here we have our 150 grams.
You put an egg into it?
You could put an egg. Oh, yeah, a lot of people put eggs into scones. Now, we make...
What difference would that make?
It makes it stay fresh longer.
Right.
And it's richer in taste.
More kind of cakey than a scone, would it be?
It is a bit, yeah. I prefer it without the egg, to be honest. Now, you make the mixture quite sticky, as you see there. If that's too dry, you're going to have hard lumps of dough. Turn it onto the...
If you wanted to make a fruit scone, is this where you
put
the fruit
in? Now, here,
you
add the fruit in.
Before you add the milk. Yeah. Okay.
Now, here, you could add some ground ginger and serve it with ginger jam, as I have there.
Oh, ground ginger? Well, that's not a traditional scone, is it?
No, but the variations I've given you.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Okay? Now, you could add some lemon rind and use some lemon curd. I love lemon curd. Mm. Or you can use a traditional... cream, jam and butter. Nice. Now, don't handle it much. Roll it around like so. We're going to put this in and we're going to heat the tin. This is important for your scones.
Preheat the tin.
You're going to quickly, the heat will get it to rise.
Yeah.
Now, generally, if I'm in a hurry,
pizza.
I put the scones on. I put the oven on before I start making the scones. But if you want to, you know, make them in advance, it helps if you put your dough into the fridge while your oven is heating to cool it down. And I had, not this one, but the one that just come out in the fridge. Now, we're just doing a sample few here.
Would you be worried, though, that the inside might not cook
properly if it's cold coming out of the fridge?
No, because it's going into 220 degrees, Tommy.
Oh, it's going to be very hot.
220, very hot oven.
Right.
And that's going to preheat the tin and it's going to quickly bake the scones and rise them, wow, as you saw
how
there.
How long do they go in for, Catherine?
10 to 15 minutes max.
Max?
Yeah.
Can I have one?
You can indeed, darling.
Well, are they ready?
Are they ready open when they're...
Go on, why not? Like,
now, here we go.
Smell delicious.
Look at this.
Oh, here we go now.
No knife.
This is the test.
Oh,
look at that.
Look at that.
And there's nothing doughy about them.
Wouldn't get that in our days, would you?
Look at looking at me when you say that.
What are you talking about?
I didn't say they were going to be doughy.
Now.
Right, so you're just cutting
another
them up
tip,
there.
Another
look
tip.
At that. Fairness, Catherine.
Now,
literally just.
That's what you should
open.
Do. And even if they're cold, they should still just break.
And look,
when
it's
I
not
was growing up, you never.
Either.
No, you never cut a scone with a knife. Twist it, and that's a perfect scone.
That
now.
Wow.
Another tip.
Because they crumble all the
they're
time.
They're always falling
never,
crumble.
You'd never be able to do that in a cafe or a restaurant, no.
Now, the next tip, never twist your cutter. Stab it down into the dough.
Okay.
See, like so? There we go. I've got that from Edward Hayden.
Why can't like you so. Twist it?
Because you want to get a flying top on it.
A what?
A flying top. Have you ever seen a scone or scone where one half has gone up this way?
Oh, yeah, I have.
That's called a flying top.
A wonky scone.
Yeah, and you get a flying top on a bread as well. Now, another reason you can get the flying top is if your seal on your oven door isn't great. And just to mention to people, particularly with scones, or pastry, test your oven by putting an envelope in and just see if it moves around the door when you close it.
Oh.
If it moves, your seal on your door isn't working properly.
Mm.
Now, another little tip for everybody.
I have it.
And make sure it doesn't go on fire.
Stop that, you. Go on fire.
Right, now, so then you take out the baking tray. It should be roasting hot.
It should, the flour, take that out there for you.
And then,
you just your flour should be brown, actually. Is it browned?
Yes, it is.
Lovely.
Go on fire.
Now, look at this. Not going on fire. Onto the hot tin.
Okay.
Back into the oven, Alan.
Back to work there now.
Back to work. Into the preheated oven, as I said.
10 to 15 minutes.
10 to 15 minutes.
On a high shelf?
Upper shelf position, 220, and make sure the oven is at temperature.
Well, Catherine,
there's a whole lot more here to go.
Classic.
Oh, do you know what I have as well for you?
Oh, what?
A bit of cream.
Ah, now she tells us.
And a bit of Baileys.
What's the Baileys for? Oh, jeez, we're happy days.
Oh, Baileys cream.
Yeah.
Well, Catherine, we're going to need it for what's coming up next.
We're going to be
James is street tonight.
What are
we going to do?
Are you going to stay for our...
I can't miss this.
You're going to have to hang around with you.
In fact, can I tell you?
Ringside seats.
Can I tell you? Mirren said to me earlier, they're all your age group, you know, who go to see them.
Oh, what's your age group?
Me.
Mirren.
And I said...
Mirren O'Connell's she's going to be joining you.
Hold on. Hold on, can I tell you, Tommy? At my age, they should be on their knees getting ready to meet their maker, not going to that sort of nonsense. Merciful hour. Anyway, they're your lovely, light, well-risen scones.
Well, listen,
Hughes is having a heart attack here.
If you want to be on your knees watching Magic Mike or the Magic Men from Down Under teach myself and Alan how to dance, that's coming up next.
Give them some scones as well.
See you in a minute. You're very welcome back. Now we've got changed because it's time for something a little bit different now on Ireland AIM, where we will turn up the heat. That's Catherine Layden in the background. And also time to distract those little eyes and ears. So if the kids aren't in school this morning, maybe time to send them out to play in football or something.
Joining us now to celebrate the launch of their world tour and talk us through literal ups and downs of the show or cast members from Magic Men. But before we chat to them, let's have a look at what they do best.
Ladies, what you are about to witness is real.
Yeah, so they're gardeners.
That was very tame.
That was a bit tame there. Good morning to you.
Will Parfitt and Caesar Smith, good morning to you
both.
Great to have you with us.
Good morning.
Where are you from, Will?
I'm from London originally, but I live in Melbourne, Australia now.
Okay, and Caesar?
Same thing, Melbourne, Australia.
Okay, because you're over here in Dublin, the big performance, I think, over the next couple of days. But tell us about Magic Men. Caesar, where did the idea of... Well, I can guess where it came from, but tell us
how did it all start?
It all started with a founder by the name of Carlos Fang, who thought of an idea of creating a stripping company in Australia, and then next thing I know, this Channing wannabe or lookalike was in a club one night, and Carlos picked him out, and next thing you know, here we are today touring the world for Magic Man Australia.
And of course, well, I mean, the resemblance with Channing Tatum and obviously the connection with the Magic Mike movies. I mean, it is incredible. And you get that all the time, obviously.
All the time, yeah, especially since TikTok and my social media just blown up with Channing Tatum comments. So
yeah,
it's still a bit weird.
Have you ever, has he ever got in touch with you? Have you any links kind of between him and like pretty much your doppelganger?
No, we've never met. We've never met.
He probably thinks that this guy's better looking.
He's probably like, this guy's just milking
it. But look at it. Look at, like, you see, we had a shot of you earlier on with you and Channing. I mean, and the resemblance is uncanny. It's amazing.
Yeah, we do look similar in some photos, I guess.
Yeah, but you're playing up to it as well on your TikTok and on your Instagram. It's very good for business.
No, yeah, people do love it when I play up to it a little bit. So
and of course, Magic Mike the movie, like, huge success. Channing Tatum was the star of the show in that. Talk to me about the Magic Men though, because obviously you're living over in Melbourne at the minute.
Yeah.
Like this, but this has become a worldwide event. Like, you're in Dublin at the minute, you're traveling all over Europe and the US as well.
Yeah, it's absolutely crazy. Like, from where we started, we just started at the end of after the first movie came out, we started a company called Magic Men. And then we were literally doing a show for like 20, 30 girls in Australia, like performing on the floor, basically, for anyone who'd come and watch us. Yeah. And then social media took off, and now, yeah, we're touring the world, doing the whole of the UK, Germany, Denmark, USA, Canada. So, yeah, it's actually crazy to where it's come to now.
And Caesar, I mean, we think, oh, you're getting up and you're doing this type of show, but obviously a lot of work goes into it. The routines are hard. And, I mean, the physique. And then to look the part, I mean, is it constant training?
There is, mate. There honestly is. And it depends who you're talking about here. If you're talking about the rest of the boys, the rest of the boys, you know, put in hard work. They're working tirelessly 3 or 4 days a week in the studio, doing all the rehearsals and stuff like that. But when you've got Will Parfitt, he turns up in his $500,000 car. We're rolling out the red carpet, jumps on stage and then takes all the spotlight. So, yeah, that's where it's at.
So, are you telling me he's like the Ronaldo of the team?
Gets paid like the Ronaldo of the team, I tell you.
I mean, how long is the show? So, are there solos and then there's the big group numbers? What are you laughing about?
Yeah, there's group routines, there's solo acts, and it's so crowd interactive. We literally get 30 to 50 crowd members up on stage with us during the show, and they're picked on the night.
By scouts outside or just by yourselves?
By ourselves.
Oh, really?
Because there's been a lot of talk in Ireland about the pleasure boys up in the Devonish, up north.
We've heard
a lot of stories.
We've seen some videos we didn't want to see.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of us have seen videos we didn't want to see.
We've all seen it. But I know you guys, it's not at the same level of, not same sort of show, no, Caesar, not, to the same not. Level. And as well as that, because even you're up in Belfast and I gather like they were storming the stage as well, but it's not... It's a little bit more PG, is it?
Completely opposite, to be honest.
Okay.
It's so most of these guys that actually do work and perform for us are professional dancers. We've got acrobatics in our show as well. So as I said before, there's a lot of work that goes into this, tirelessly work, and majority of these boys are full-time working for Magic Men.
Okay. You're going to show us some moves. So what would be the main moves if myself and Tommy decided to join the act? What would we be doing? What are the core moves, should we say?
Come on, lads. This is our audition.
This is the audition. All right, so we're going to...
Caesar, I'll talk you through it.
Caesar's going to show you how to do
the body roll.
Body roll is to start with. So you start at the chin. Chest out, and then work your way down to the hips.
grab your shirt.
There you go.
And you pull it off.
All right.
Oh,
okay.
Is that it?
So we do a body roll, then grab the shirt and take it off.
Hold on, do it from the top there. Oh, he's got the shirt off.
He's been doing it all night. I know. So, like,
Is that like basically the basic move when somebody comes
that's
in?
Step number one.
Is that step number one? Is
you, you need a little bit of baby oil on there as well, and just.
So you start. You say you start at the chin.
Right. Pull your chin
chest.
Back.
Chin back.
Pull your chest back. Almost
and
down.
Then work the hips. Okay. Work the hips.
And just grab your shirt and just Tommy, I think we need some music. Do we need some music?
What kind of music
goes with this now? Is it?
It's going to have to be Pony, isn't it? We're going to milk the channel.
Okay, can we have this? We need this bouncing up.
Okay.
Come on, right. We can't hear it in studio. We get it on the floor? Can we get it on the floor? Come on. Yeah, here we go.
Right,
yeah.
Here we go.
Are we ready, Sil?
Come on, Will, get the gear off.
Here we go. All right. Come on. Here we go.
Right.
All right, let's do it.
Body rock?
Yeah.
And then take your shirt off.
Look at this.
Three, two, one.
Oh.
Right.
Okay, here we go. Are you ready?
Rip it.
It won't rip.
Okay.
Let's go.
So, you're in. Guys, you're in the Civic Theatre in Tala tonight and tomorrow night, so people can contact the Civic and get, there's only a few tickets left. Yeah. magicman.com.au is Eric. That's where you can get the tickets. I'm sure it's going to be fun tonight.
Listen, thank you, mate.
So come on, just give us a little
proper
dance.
Demo what you might do.
To show us out. Come on, what you might be doing tonight. Come on, here we go. Woo. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Catch them not precious as I get these scones. That's all we've time for today. Muirin, Cam Catchin down there. What's coming up tomorrow?
I'm not joking, lads. Standing beside Catherine Layden during that is one of the best moments, I think, in my life. She was like, we're in the front. They're getting paid to do this. It's great. She'll be there tonight, lads.
I will be.
She'll be there tomorrow night. Do you need a scone to calm you down?
A scone now.
What do you make of this?
A scone, lads.
All the boys are coming in now, Catherine.
Come on, lads.
Come on now. Look at this. Look at this. Tea,
hot scones. Jam, butter, cream, everything you want.
How is that for you, Catherine?
You don't get this down in the living room too often, Catherine. You all right, Catherine?
Yeah, but you came.
Do you want to stand this side, Catherine?
Oh, come here, lads.
She's going to be at the show tonight.
Oh, I am, yes.
Thank you. Coming up on tomorrow's show, he's the hilarious chemistry teacher turned TikTok star. We're going to find out why Shabazz Ali is gaining millions of followers online.
He is absolutely brilliant, Shabazz says. Plus, Louise McSherry is back on the road with her popular podcast. She'll be here to tell us all about it.
And Jennifer Rock, our skin nerd, will be testing out the latest viral trends. We'll be back tomorrow from 7. We're going to have Catherine.
She's feeding her boys.
She's feeding the boys now.
She's feeding her boys.
Have a great day. See you tomorrow.
I need to be resuscitated. This hit me in the face.
Best episode of Ireland ever.
At least that's all that hit her in the face.
The magic women are coming next.
Looking forward to that too.
Thanks, guys.
She's coming and host that with us.
Good luck tonight.
Good luck tonight.
Bye. Have a lovely day.